السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم.
عليكم السلام.
عليكم السلام ورحمة
الله. Okay, so I just want to check my voice. Okay for all of you. Can you hear me well?
Yes, it's clear, doctor.
Okay, that's good. First of all, I know that this is something away from the basis, but I have noticed in the last session when I brought the clinical scenario, including this statement, gram-positive cocci in clusters, I have received a lot of issues and I have received a lot of messages in my private WhatsApp. Several people and lots of colleagues are still confusing and they don't know how to differentiate between the gram-positive, the gram-negative, gram-positive cocci in clusters. What do they mean? Gram-positive cocci in chains. What do they mean? Gram-positive rods. What do they mean? I've decided to prepare this introductory lecture for you. I hope that it's going to be of benefit for all of you and you are going to learn something from me and vice versa also. And it's going to be a 3-hour session. I tried my best to simplify bacteriology and mycology in something that you are going to benefit in your clinical practice. So this is a medical clinical microbiology. It's not a microbiology for microbiologists, technicians, et cetera, but it's a microbiology that all physicians do need to know. So let's not waste time and let's start immediately. I just want to check the voice again. Is it okay for all of you?
Yes.
Okay, that's yes. So, Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Bismillah. So let's get the ball rolling immediately. So first of all, what's the definition of microbiology? As all of you know, microbiology is the study or the biology and the study of microorganisms. And microorganisms, actually, they are 4 subcategories of microorganisms. We have bacteriology, we have virology, we have mycology, we have parasitology, and in addition to that, we can include immunology under the umbrella of micro study of microbiology. But microorganisms, these are the microorganisms that we do fight and they do fight us also. Bacteriology, virology, and all of us right now, we are in the era of COVID-19, okay? Mycology, which is the study of fungi, and parasitology, which is the study of parasites. As I have told you, I'm going to concentrate upon bacteriology, clinical bacteriology and clinical mycology. To study virology and to study parasitology, it's something very expensive and they do need someone who is specialized, okay? So let's get the ball rolling and let's say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim to start with bacteria. I just want to raise an important point, my colleagues. If you have any comment or question, just write it down from time to time. I'm going to give a pause. I'm going to give a break to receive your queries and to receive your comments. Okay? So, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. All of you know that bacteria is a single, is a unicellular organism. It contains only one cell. And this cell has got a cell wall in addition to a membrane. And inside this membrane, there are a lot of organelles, cytoplasms, nucleus, okay, the DNA, the RNA, the ribosomes, etc., the cytoplasm, etc., etc. So, in brief, it's a cell wall in addition to a membrane enclosed organelles. What are we concerned about bacteria is how to classify bacteria in addition to or in order to get benefit from our clinical knowledge of microbiology to get benefit to be reflected in our daily practice. So, there are several methods to classify bacteria. Several methods. You can classify bacteria according to the Gram stain, and this is the most popular stain used and the most popular stain that you are going to hear about it. There are other types of stains. I'm going to mention them just in a while, but you don't need to know all of these stains if you are not specialized or if you are not interested. So, dependent upon Gram stain, you can classify bacteria into Gram positive and Gram negative. And we are going to see in a while how to differentiate between Gram positive and Gram negative. Another method to classify bacteria is upon morphology. Another method you can classify bacteria according to their metabolic behavior. I mean by this, there are anaerobic bacteria and aerobic bacteria. Bacteria which need oxygen to survive and vice versa. There are bacteria which don't need oxygen to survive. These are called anaerobic bacteria, etc., etc. You don't need to know all of these, but the first two methods are integrated together. Gram stain and morphology. You have to integrate them together to have a good classification to direct your clinical decision later on. What do I mean by this? In this slide, you can see here, the mouse is dancing in front of a coccus, a round shape bacteria. Coccus, round shape. The next one here, the mouse is dancing in front of a rod bacteria. Bacillus bacteria, in Arabic we call it asawiya. The third one here is a shape in between, rounded shape and a rod shape. We call it coccobacillus, something in between. You can see also here a fusiform bacillus. You can see here a spirochete organism. You can see here a Vibrio-like organism. So bacteria, they do differ in morphology. We have cocci, we have bacilli, we have coccobacilli, etc., etc. And basically, you have to know that bacteria are colorless. Bacteria are colorless. So to know or to differentiate between bacteria, we have to give them, we have to provide them something to differentiate between, is it a gram positive or gram negative? Dependent upon a component of that cell wall, and we are going to see what are the components, dependent upon that component of the cell wall, bacteria, they do differ into gram positive and gram negative. There are several types of stains. You don't need to know all of these stains unless you are specialized. But as a general practitioner, you need to know about the Gram stain and acid fast stain. And they are in red colors, as you can see in front of you. There are different types of stains. We have silver stain. We have Gimsa stain. We have India ink stain, we have fluorescent stains, etc., etc. But all of these, as I have told you, they are sophisticated and advanced. You don't need to know all of these. Again and again, here you can see there are three circles. Number one, number two, and number three. In the first circle here, you can see a rounded shape, blue in color, clusters together. This is a very characteristic shape of Staphylococcus species, gram-positive cocci in clusters. In clusters, we mean it in Arabic like anqudiyya, زي anqud al-inab. Mujamma'a, cluster together, زي anqud al-inab. Like a grape, like clusters of grape. The second circle here, you can see blue color, small rounded. They are in a queue, like in Arabic, السبحة. زي السبحة يا إخواننا. You can see here, they are in a queue, rounded shape, small, blue color, in a queue, in a chain. This is a gram-positive cocci in chain. And these are either streptococci or enterococci. Don't worry, I'm going to give you a very clear classification after a while. Don't worry, I'm just giving you now an example. The third circle here, you can see a blue color, diplococci, small rounded. Each cocci has got another pair of cocci, زوجيات مع بعض. زوجيات, diplo, that's why we call it diplococci. And this is a characteristic shape of Streptococcus pneumoniae. In contrast here, you can see also three circles, gram-negative bacilli, red shape, round, not rounded, but bacilli, rod in shape, red in color. Here you can see red color, diplococci, in contrast to the previous one, which is blue-colored diplococci. And this is a characteristic feature of Neisseria organisms, either Neisseria gonorrhea or Neisseria meningitis. We are going to see this after a while, inshallah. And here also you can see clusters or gush of gram-negative coccobacilli, something in between the cocci and in between the bacilli, something in between. And this is a very characteristic shape of several types of organisms, inshallah. This is another picture also. You can see here, while with the mouse is dancing in front of gram-positive. What do I mean by gram-positive? I mean by this something blue. And you can, if you cannot differentiate between the color of the gram-positive versus gram-negative, don't forget these mnemonics or this trick. Gram-positive, blue in color, B and P, B and P, B and P. P-positive, B, blue. So the gram-positive is blue in color, while gram-negative is red in color. Okay, so this is a very important slide. Here you can see gram-positive cell wall. As I have told you, bacteria is unicellular, is an organism contains only one cell. This cell is composed of a cell wall and a membrane inside this cell wall. Is it important to know this, these components? Yes, it's very important because bacteria, as I have told you, are colorless. Okay, so if they are, since they are colorless, Dr. Morsi, now you just told us the positive is blue and the negative is red. So how is this? This is something confusing. I'm going to tell you that dependent upon a specific component inside the cell wall, the bacteria will uptake the gram stain to give you the color. We will see now. I just need one volunteer. Who's going to volunteer? I need to discuss some issue with one volunteer. Who's going to volunteer for me? Who is interested? Any volunteer? Or shall I pick up? Okay, the first one, Dr. Abdul Wahab. This Dr. Rishi. Dr. Rishi.
Yes, sir.
Okay, how are you, Dr. Rishi?
I'm fine, thanks. How are you, sir?
Alhamdulillah, fine. Okay, Dr. Rishi, you can see this slide in front of you right now. Am I right?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you just concentrate here, the gram-positive cell wall, gram-negative cell wall? Do you see any difference?
Yeah, there is a one more membrane in the gram-negative bacteria that is not there in the gram-positive.
Okay, this is number one, the outer membrane, which presents in the negative gram-negative, and it is not present in gram-positive. This is the first difference. What is the second difference?
Very periplasmic space.
Periplasmic space is wide in gram negative while it is narrow in gram positive.
The thickness of the wall is less in the gram negative bacteria compared to gram positive.
Okay, you can see here the thickness of the peptidoglycan. Remember this protein. Peptidoglycan is thick in the gram-positive, while it is very thin in the gram-negative, as you can see here. In contrast, there are two types of membranes in the gram-negative. We have the outer membrane and we have the inner membrane, while in gram-positive, we have only inner membrane. Okay, let's take to a scope upon gram positive. You can see here, this is the cell wall. This is the peptidoglycan layer. You see how thick it is. And this is the inner membrane of the gram positive. This is the inner membrane, and this is the peptidoglycan layer. What does it contain, this peptidoglycan layer? It contains this type of protein. Remember this protein, teichoic acid. Teichoic acid. Remember this protein because it's very important to all of us. Teichoic acid. Teichoic acid, the peptidoglycan layer in the gram positive is very rich in teichoic acid. While you can see here in contrast, this is the wall of the gram negative. This is the outer membrane, as you can see here. And this is the peptidoglycan layer. You see how thin it is. And in addition to that, there is no teichoic acid in peptidoglycan layer of the gram-negative organisms. And this is the inner membrane. So what is the value of presence of teichoic acid in the gram positive while it is not present in the gram negative? Actually, the value you can see here in this table, peptidoglycan layer in the gram positive, it constitutes 90% of the cell wall, while it is a very thin layer in the gram negative. Concentrate here. The second difference is the teichoic acid. It constitutes about 10% of the cell wall while it is not present in the gram negative. And actually, This stearic acid is the acid responsible for uptaking the gram stain, reflecting a positive color of the gram positive organisms, while it is not present in the gram negative, so it will be reflected as a red color. I hope that is clear, ya jamaa. Is it clear?
Yes.
Did you understand it right now? Or shall I repeat?
Yeah. Please.
Understood to all of you? You can reply in the chat box, no problem. Understood? Okay, do you have any questions so far? Any questions so far? Yes, the teichoic acid is the component that is responsible for uptaking the gram stain, reflecting the blue color. So it is not present in the gram negative, so it will be reflected as a red color organism. The teichoic acid is the one, is the component which is uptaking the gram stain. Okay, you can see here another difference. The gram negative, they do contain lipopolysaccharides, endotoxins and exotoxins. Endotoxins, while lipopolysaccharides are not present in. Minute, please.
Opening pronunciations.
Lipopolysaccharides are not present in the gram-positive. You don't need to know all of these detailed differences, but you need to know that the peptidoglycan here is thick in the gram-positive, while it is thin in the gram-negative. Gram-positive, they do contain teichoic acid, while negative, gram-negative, they lack teichoic acid. Gram-positive, they lack lipopolysaccharide, while gram-negative, they do contain lipopolysaccharide. So, concentrate with me in this slide. Now, as I have told you previously, I will just go back to this slide. Bacterial classification. As I have told you, there are several methods to depend upon to classify bacteria. But the most important ones are gram stain and morphology. When I say gram-positive cocci, I mean this is a gram-positive, and the morphology of this gram-positive is coccus in shape. So these two classifications are integrated together. Okay? So let's go to this important slide. This slide is classifying the gram-positive cocci. Now I will start with the gram-positive. We will have gram-positive cocci and gram-positive bacilli. This slide is going to classify the gram-positive cocci. First of all, concentrate with me, please. You have here, gram-positive cocci. We have aerobic and anaerobic. Examples of anaerobic, we have Peptococcus and Peptostreptococcus. Usually they are normal commensals of the mouth and oral flora, Peptococcus and Peptostreptococcus. Forget about them, but concentrate with me here. If you have a sample of any side, blood, urine, sputum, every side, you send it for the lab, okay? And they do put the gram stain and the uptake reflected as blue. So, first of all, this is a gram positive. This is a gram positive. We want to know it. Is it a gram positive cocci or gram positive bacilli? From the shape, they will know under the microscope. It's a blue color, coccus in shape. Blue color, coccus in shape. So this is a gram positive cocci. We have three types of gram positive cocci. Follow the mouse, please. Follow the arrow. We have staphylococcus. We have streptococcus. We have enterococcus. The gram positive cocci are three types. Either staphylococcus, streptococcus, or enterococcus. So how do we differentiate between them in the lab? First of all, as I have told you, since the start, the technician okay, put the gram stain, and under the microscope, he saw gram-positive cocci. Blue cocci. So these are either staphylococcus or streptococcus or enterococcus. If he wants to differentiate, he will supply the catalase enzyme. If it tends to be positive, this is a staphylococcus. If it tends to be negative, this either streptococcus or enterococcus. Forget about streptococcus and enterococcus now and concentrate with me upon staphylococcus. So, catalase enzyme is going to differentiate between staphylococcus and strept and entero. Staphylococcus is positive catalase, while other two are negative catalase. So, this is a staphylococcus species. Up to now, it is a staphylococcus species. But what type of staphylococcus? Then after that, we will have the coagulase enzyme test. If it tends to be positive coagulase, this is a staph aureus. And there is no any species, other species, rather than staph aureus, which is coagulase positive. The only coagulase positive among staphylococcus species is the staph aureus. If it tends to be coagulase negative, this is a very big family called coagulase negative staph. And under the umbrella of this family, there are different species: staph epidermidis, staph saprophyticus, staph capitis, staph hemolyticus, etc., etc., etc. Again and again, if it is a staph aureus, up to now it's a staph aureus, but I don't know. Is it methicillin sensitive or methicillin resistant? They will test it with the oxacillin disc. Oxacillin disc, this is a disc. It's similar to a capsule or a tablet. They will put it in the plate and they will see if there is an inhibition growth around this plate. It means that the colonies are sensitive to this disc that contains oxacillin. It means that it is methicillin sensitive staph aureus. If there is no inhibition zone around this disc, it means that these colonies, these organisms in these colonies are resistant to that disc, resulting in MRSA, which is methicillin resistant staph aureus. I hope that is clear, ya jamaa, concerning the staph. Staphylococcus. Clear.
Okay, doctor, can you repeat?
Again. Since the beginning, it's a gram-positive cocci. Blue color, rounded in shape. Blue color, rounded in shape. I want to see, is it a staph or a stripped or enterococci? Because all of these organisms, either staph or stripped or entero, all of them are gram-positive cocci. But the staphylococcus is catalase positive, while the other two are catalase negative. So the catalase enzyme will differentiate between the staph and other gram-positive cocci, are stripto and entero. Up to here, I have a staph in front of me. I want to know, is it a coagulase positive staph or a coagulase negative staph? So I will apply the coagulase test. If it tends to be positive, this is a staph aureus. If it tends to be negative, this is coagulase negative staph family. And under the umbrella of this family, there are different species, as you can see here. For example, staph epidermidis, staph saprophyticus, etc., etc. If it is a coagulase positive, which is staph aureus, I need to know, is it an MSSA methicillin sensitive staph aureus or methicillin resistant staph aureus? By applying oxacillin disc. There are a special type of discs. The disc is like a tablet that contains antibiotic. You put it in the plate, for example, the plate that contains the colonies of this bacteria. Once you put the plate and you come tomorrow to check it, if there is an inhibition zone around this plate, so it means that the organisms are sensitive to that disc. Am I right? Because there is an inhibition zone. Am I right?
Okay.
If there is no an inhibition zone, it means that the bacteria are resistant to that disc. And by this, I can differentiate between methicillin-sensitive staph aureus and methicillin-resistant staph aureus. Hope that is clear. I need to repeat again. Is it clear, ya jamaa? Okay. Okay. So by this, we finish from the Staphylococcus species. But let's go back a little bit, two steps to the back. We have gram-positive cocci. So we want to see, is it a staph or a stripped or entero? We will apply the catalase enzyme. It tends to be positive. Khalas, this is a staph species, no doubt. But if it tends to be negative, so this is either streptococci or enterococci. And how to differentiate between streptococci and enterococci? Another test, another enzyme, it is called PYR. It's an abbreviation of a long name. I will send it to you, inshallah, in the group, but it is called PYR enzyme. If the PYR enzyme tends to be positive, this is enterococcus. If it tends to be negative, this is streptococcus. An enterococcus is a big family, and under the umbrella of this family, we have Enterococcus faecalis, we have Enterococcus faecium, we have Enterococcus gallinarum, we have vancomycin-resistant enterococci, etc., etc. And by the way, formerly, previously, enterococci was classified under the umbrella of streptococci, but now it is a different entity. Enterococci is a different entity. It is no more under the umbrella of streptococci. Okay? And previously, enterococci, as I have told you, was classified under the umbrella of streptococci by the name of group B streptococci. But now it is a different entity. So, catalase negative, this is either stript or entero. Apply the PYR enzyme test if it is positive. So, this is enterococci. If it is negative, this is a streptococci. Now let's come to the streptococci itself. Streptococci itself, you can divide it into two big categories. The green color you can see here, the beta hemolytic and alpha hemolytic. Dependent upon what? Dependent upon reaction of these organisms inside the culture plate. I have a very nice slide for you. The alpha hemolytic will form a partial hemolysis to the culture plate, while the beta hemolytic will form a complete hemolysis. We are going to see that. But I want from all of you to know that streptococci are divided into alpha hemolytic and beta hemolytic. The alpha hemolytic, there are several species under the umbrella of alpha hemolytic. But the most important for all of us as clinicians are Streptococcus viridans and Streptococcus pneumoniae. While species under the umbrella of beta hemolytic, there are different species. They are classified into groups from A to Z. But the most important for us as clinicians, group A, which is Streptococcus pyogenes, and group B, which is Streptococcus agalactiae. I hope that this slide is very clear, ya jamaa, because this is one of the most important slides in this session. Don't worry, I will show you different infections caused by these different organisms, but at least you know that the gram-positive cocci are either staph or stripped or entero. The staph is catalase positive, while the other two are catalase negative. Then the staph, either the coagulase positive or coagulase negative. Then the other two, which are catalase negative, either entero or stripto. PYR enzyme is positive in entero, and PYR enzyme is negative in strepto. Streptococci is divided into alpha hemolytic and beta hemolytic. Alpha hemolytic contains Streptococcus viridans group and Streptococcus pneumoniae, while beta hemolytic are classified into groups. The most important groups for us, group A, which is Streptococcus pyogenes, and group B, which is Streptococcus agalactiae. I hope that's clear, Jamaa.
Yes, clear, doctor.
That's good. PYR is an enzyme, Dr. Lubna. PYR is an enzyme. It's an abbreviation of a long name. I will send it to you in the group, inshallah. Okay. So let's move. You can see here. As you can see here, on the mouse is dancing in front of the picture. This is the characteristic feature of Staphylococcus under the microscope. Gram positive, blue in color, clusters together. Gram positive cocci in clusters. So this is another important differentiation between these two types of organisms, or these three types of gram positive. Once you receive a letter from the lab stating gram positive cocci, so you have to return it back, or you have to call the lab. Is it a gram positive cocci in clusters or in chains? You have to ask the lab about this, because the clusters, these are staphylococcus. In chains, they are either stripped or enterococci. واضح يا جماعة؟ Clear?
Yes, clear.
Okay. Small words about MRSA, methicillin resistant staph aureus. You can see here. Methicillin resistant staph aureus is a nasty organism. Anyhow, staph in general, either methicillin resistant staph aureus or methicillin sensitive staph aureus or coagulase negative staph, the take home message: don't play with staph aureus. Don't play, not aureus only, but don't play with staphylococcus species. They are nasty. They are virulent organisms. Don't play with them at all. Easy, Ajama. This is the take home message. Don't play with staphylococcus species. Commonly, they do cause skin infections, but I'm talking now here and particularly upon MRSA. They do cause skin infections, but they can do a lot of infections. Name some infections caused by MRSA, for example. Each one can name. I want volunteers, please. What can they do?
Nosocomial pneumonia.
Pneumonia, yes. What else?
Meningitis.
Meningitis, okay. They can cause meningitis.
Osteomyelitis,
it can cause meningitis, but not meningitis in particular group of patients.
Endocarditis.
Not in all types of meningitis. Okay.
Endocarditis.
Endocarditis, thank you very much. Endocarditis. What else?
Hemodialysis
osteomyelitis,
you mean?
Osteomyelitis.
Osteomyelitis, yes. Someone said about catheter. What do you mean by catheter? You mean catheter-related bloodstream infection? You mean this?
Cellulitis.
Yes, you are right. Cellulitis, bed sores, yes. Catheter-related bloodstream infection, yes. So staph is an organism which can cause several types of infections. And as you know that, it is resistant to penicillin. These are examples of IV antibiotics which work against MRSA. Vancomycin, clindamycin, daptomycin, linezolid, ciftaroline. Who knows ciftaroline? Who knows ciftaroline? I will give him a gift.
Fourth generation syphilis.
Again?
Fifth generation cephalosporin.
So all of us know that, some of us know that cephalosporins are only three generations, but no. Cephalosporins now reach up to fifth generation. And one example of fifth generation is ciftaroline. Ciftaroline is an example of a fifth generation cephalosporin. And by the way, take this information because it's very useful in your clinical practice. Do other cephalosporins cover MRSA or not? First, second, third, and fourth.
Sorry, doctor, repeat the question.
Question. Do two other types of generations of cephalosporins. I mean, first, second, third, and fourth generation.
First generation.
Do they cover staph or not? MRSA.
No, they don't cover MRSA.
Cefazolin, the first generation.
I'm talking about
not MRSA.
MRSA.
No, MRSA.
So all generations of cephalosporins except fifth generation, they don't cover MRSA. MRSA. I'm talking about MRSA.
No.
Okay. The fifth generation, which is ceftaroline, it does cover MRSA. Okay.
Any other example
of IV antibiotic which can cover MRSA apart from what is mentioned here?
Doctor, rifampicin.
We will see now rifampicin where to use it with staff. But per se, it is not. Can you give rifampicin alone for staff MRSA alone?
Decoplanin.
Teicoplanin, yes. Teicoplanin. Thank you very much, doctor.
Minocycline, tigecycline,
doxycycline. Yes, you are right. So there are several IV antibiotics.
Meropenem.
Can cover. Again?
No, not by meropenem.
Meropenem.
No, meropenem does not cover MRSA.
Meropenem cover Pseudomonas.
Who said meropenem?
Sir, me, Sabir.
No, meropenem does not cover MRSA, but it can cover other types of staph.
Okay, thank you.
In particular, meropenem, carbapenem group, in particular, they don't cover MRSA. You can write vancomycin, teicoplanin, tigecycline, clindamycin, daptomycin, lanizolide, ceftaroline. All of these are examples of IV antibiotics that do cover MRSA. Do we have oral options? Yes, we have oral options. For example, ciprofloxacin can cover MRSA. Clindamycin can cover MRSA. Erythromycin can cover MRSA. Tetracyclines, for example, doxycycline can cover MRSA. Trimethoprim, sulfamethoxazole, which is the Bactrim, can cover MRSA. Lanizolide, there are two forms of lanizolide. IV and oral form, they do cover MRSA. But now I will give you a clinical trick. Please concentrate with me, especially GPs covering primary health care clinics. Concentrate with me. We have two types of patients. I will give you a verbal scenarios, two scenarios now. Two types of patients, 35-year-old patient A, 35-year-old patient B. Patient A has a wound, patient B has a wound. Both of them has wound infections. They came and they saw you in the clinic. You took a swab from both of them. You send it to the lab. The result came back as MRSA for both of them. Both of them are fit and well. Both of them, they don't have any clinical or comorbidities. Patient A, the MRSA antibiogram, it came. Also, patient B, the antibiogram, it came. And the patient is stable in front of you, and you decided to give them oral options. Oral options. The first patient, you give him clindamycin oral, while the second patient, who share similar characteristic features, even for the wound, patient B, but you decided not to give him clindamycin after you saw the antibiogram or the sensitivity. What is the reason? Did you understand my question now? Patient A.
It will depend on the condition of the patient, doctor.
It doesn't, no. I told you the condition of both patients are similar.
Maybe bacteria not sensitive?
No, it is written sensitive for clindamycin. Both of them. Dr. Rishi, thank you very much. Inducible resistance. Dr. Rishi, what do you look for before you prescribe clindamycin?
This resistant to erythromycin and the D-shaped inducible resistant to clindamycin.
Forget about the D-shape. This is something advanced, but we want something. Yes, you are right. Before you prescribe, you are right, Dr. Rishi. Thank you very much. So, colleagues, before you have to prescribe clindamycin or MRSA,
resistant to erythromycin.
Please, yes, you are right. Please, please, before you prescribe clindamycin, you have to look for the sensitivity of this organism to erythromycin. If it is sensitive to erythromycin, you can prescribe clindamycin safely. But if it is resistant to erythromycin and sensitive to clindamycin, don't ever give clindamycin, because if it is resistant to erythromycin, you will induce resistance easily to clindamycin even after taking one single tablet of clindamycin. I hope that's clear, Jamal.
Clear?
Oh, all of you know that?
Doctor, please repeat.
Describing clindamycin, you have to look for the sensitivity to erythromycin. Even it is written clindamycin sensitive. Don't depend only upon this. Look for erythromycin. If it is sensitive, prescribe clindamycin safely. If it is resistant, erythromycin resistant, don't prescribe clindamycin, even if clindamycin is sensitive, because of inducible resistance to clindamycin. Inducible resistance to clindamycin. Okay. Clear? Can I move?
Yes, doctor.
Yes, yes.
That's good. Okay. So you can see here, different and varieties of infections caused by Staphylococcus aureus, for example. You can divide it into toxin-mediated infections and non-toxin-mediated infections. As all of you said, food poisoning can be caused by Staph aureus, toxic shock syndrome, scaled skin syndrome, non-toxin-mediated skin and soft tissue infection, osteomyelitis, endocarditis, septicemia, pneumonia, meningitis, arthritis, etc. Different varieties of infections. And please, as I have told you, don't play with staph, or in general, don't play with bacteria. While azim, bacteria are clever, and we will see how clever are they, inshallah. Another type of staphylococcus, which is coagulase negative, as I have told you, coagulase negative is a big family, and under the umbrella of this family, we have different species. You need to know about two species, Staph epidermidis, because they are one of the very well-known causative organisms of infective endocarditis, Staph epidermidis. And you need to know about Staph saprophyticus. It is a very common causative organism of urinary tract infection in teenage females. In teenage females. I hope that's clear, Jamal. Clear? Okay. Who, when I ask about antibiotics covering MRSA, some of our colleagues here mentioned rifampicin. Who's that?
I am doctor.
Could you introduce yourself, doctor, please?
Dr. Muhammad Husni.
Dr. Muhammad Husni. How are you, Dr. Muhammad?
Fine, sir. Fine, doctor. Thank you.
What can you see here, Dr. Muhammad?
Like a piece of like something like jelly.
Something like jelly. I like your word, Dr. Muhammad. Something like jelly. Yes. It's a gelatinous material. Gelatinous material. Have you ever heard about this term, biofilm? Biofilm?
Yes, biofilm is like some material contained proteins and polysaccharide that regulate that some bacteria made, like Pseudomonas aeruginosa also can made to provide stocking to tissues and getting nutrition.
Thank you very much, doctor.
Welcome, doctor.
Thank you very much. So you know a lot about biofilm, but in particular, are you afraid from formation of biofilm in all infections or in particular type of infections?
In all infection, because it increases the virulence of the bacteria, or some kinds of fungi also increase the virulence.
Okay, I do agree with you, but in particular in clinical practice, we will be afraid from biofilm if there are prostheses,
joints, like joints and valves.
Like joints, like valves in the heart. Okay, and basically, biofilm, as you can see here, colleagues, it's a gelatinous material. Contains different types of proteins and lipids. I'm going just to simplify it for you. It's something very, by the way, very complicated, but you need to know that. It's a type of defensive mechanism that bacteria, in particular, staph bacteria, they do form this biofilm, which is the gelatinous material, which is very sticky, to be underneath it. What do I mean by this? If you have a prosthesis, for example, prosthetic joint in the hip or in the knee, or if you have a valve in the heart, metallic valve, these are metallic prostheses. If you have got an infection with staph species, one of the characteristic features or virulent factors that these staph form is formation of biofilm. They form this layer and they will hide underneath this layer. If you give a lot of antibiotics cannot penetrate this gelatinous layer. And the bacteria will be safe staying under it, eating, chatting, etc., etc., looking to the antibiotics coming from up with no ability to penetrate this layer. So, to penetrate this layer, we have to use some types of antibiotics that do have ability to penetrate this biofilm to give other antibiotics a safe space to go and kill the bacteria. One of them, and the most popular, is rifampicin. And if you review the guidelines American Heart Association guidelines, for example, of infective endocarditis, you will not see rifampicin in native valves, but you will see rifampicin in prosthetic valve. What is the benefit of rifampicin? Is to break the biofilm only. This is the role of rifampicin. I hope that's clear, Anima. I need this point to be clear to all of you. Is it clear?
Clear.
Do you find it interesting, interesting or boring?
So interesting, doctor. Thank you.
Alhamdulillah. Okay. So the take-home message, don't forget, if you have a prosthesis and a staph infection, don't forget the biofilm. Don't forget the biofilm. There are other types of bacteria which have the ability to form biofilm, like Pseudomonas, for example. There are other types of antibiotics that do fight biofilm, like ciprofloxacin, for example, like ceftazidine, for example. But you don't need to know all of these details. But know that biofilm means that I'm talking about staph infection in the presence of a prosthesis. So I need to give this patient an antibiotic to break this biofilm. For example, I will give him rifampicin. Okay, that's good. Right. I need a volunteer, please. A female volunteer this time. Come on, guys, female volunteer, come on. Shall I pick up?
طيب السلام عليكم.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله. Could you please introduce yourself, doctor?
Okay, my name is Sumaya. I'm a general practitioner.
Yes, hello, Dr. Sumaya. Okay, could you please read the question in front of us? Read it loudly, please.
Okay. A 32-year-old farmer presented to the local medical unit with complaint of fever, confusion, started 6 hours ago. On examination, his blood pressure was 84 over 59. Mm-hmm. His pulse rate was 121. His oxygen saturation was 94. Extensive desquamating rashes were found on his upper and lower.
Upper and lower, okay. Palms and soles, involving palms and soles.
Okay. Total was 17.6. His hemoglobin was 14, platelets 110. His urea was 8, creatinine 134. What is the most likely diagnosis?
Take it one by one, Dr. Sumaya. This is a farmer, okay?
Okay.
Who has fever, confusion, 6 hours back. He is in a shock state. His blood pressure is low.
Yes.
Okay. He has extensive desquamating rashes found in upper and lower limbs involving palms and soles. He has renal impairment, as creatinine is 134.
Yes.
He has thrombocytopenia.
Yes.
And he has a wound. You can notice a wound in his left big toe. So what is your most likely diagnosis?
Is it a septic shock?
He's in shock. He's in shock.
Yes, but the type of shock, septic shock?
It's a septic shock, yes. But what is it secondary to? Septic shock, it's supposed to be secondary to an infection. What type of infection does he have?
Most probably to this wound in his big toe.
Yes, With this clinical picture, with this lab, laboratory findings, What do you suspect? A very, very, very acute, hyperacute. Within 6 hours, he presented with this picture. What are you afraid from? Okay, doctor, you need help?
Yeah,
Dr. Sarah, you can help Dr. Sumaya. Yes, Dr. Sarah. Hello, Dr. Sarah. Dr. Sumaya, do you know what is the diagnosis?
Okay. I read it from the comments.
Uh-huh. Okay. so you did cheating, huh?
Yes, I did.
Okay. So the diagnosis is toxic shock syndrome. And this is the CDC criteria for toxic shock syndrome. If you have a fever more than 38.9, if you have hypotension, blood pressure systolic less than 90, diastolic less than 60, if you have rashes, including palms and soles, and these rashes are squamating rashes, in addition to 3 systems failure, at least, this patient has got renal impairment. This is number one. This patient has got confusion. This is involvement of a CNS. This patient has got thrombocytopenia. This is an involvement of the blood disorder. So 3 systems failure, in addition to squamating rash, fever more than 38.9, and hypotension, this is most likely toxic shock syndrome, which is caused by what?
Staphylococcus.
Staph aureus, not Staphylococcus. Don't say Staphylococcus, I will be very angry. Staph aureus, say Staph aureus, okay? By this, we have finished from Staphylococcus. Do you have any questions so far? Any questions so far?
What is the difference between scalded skin syndrome and toxic shock syndrome? Any?
I will send it to you in the group, Java. Sure.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Any questions so far? Training staff before I move to strip and intiru. Any questions? Are they clear, ya Shabab? When I say Shabab, I mean males and females, okay? So this is not a discrimination.
Clear, Dr. Muhammad.
Okay, that's good. Okay, that's good. Okay. So let's move now to Streptococcus. Streptococcus. Returning back to this slide. It's a very important slide. Returning back to this slide. Gram-positive cocci. Either staph, we have finished with the staph, or stripped or entero. Stripped is PYR enzyme negative, and the entero is PYR enzyme positive. Go and see what is Enterococcus species. As I have told you, the Streptococcus species are divided into 2 subcategories, not 3. Forget about gamma. This is something obsolete. Okay? Streptococcus, either alpha hemolytic or beta hemolytic. According to what? You can see now the hemolysis on the blood agar. The plate, this is a plate. What can you see here in the middle? And what can you see here in the periphery? What can you see? A volunteer. Is it clear?
Greenish time.
Greenish, thank you very much. And here, it's colorless.
Whitish.
It's not, it's colorless, yes, colorless. The greenish colonies, it's called alpha hemolytic. And the complete hemolysis is the beta hemolytic. Getting back to this slide. Alpha hemolysis, it forms partial hemolysis. Alpha hemolytic streptococci form partial hemolysis, giving the greenish discoloration around the colonies. Greenish discoloration. While beta hemolytic, they form complete hemolysis. So it will give you a clear zone around the colonies in the plate. The alpha hemolytic streptococci, the most important two species are Streptococcus pneumoniae and Streptococcus viridans. And by the way, Streptococcus viridans is a big family, and under the umbrella of this family, there are different species. Beta hemolytic will give you a complete hemolysis. And they are classified into different groups, group A, group B, group C, until group H. Not all of you are important as clinicians, but the most important groups for you are group A, which is a Streptococcus biogenes, and group B, which is a Streptococcus agalactiae. Previously, as I have told you, they were a third subcategory, which is gamma hemolytic, which is the group D enterococcus. As I have told you now, the enterococcus is a different entity. So the take-home message, classification of streptococci, alpha hemolytic and beta hemolytic only. So you can see here different varieties of streptococcus infections. Streptococcus pneumoniae can cause pneumonia, meningitis, sepsis. Streptococcus viridans, very well known causative organism of endocarditis. Streptococcus biogenes, which is group A, beta hemolytic. It can cause pyogenic infections and non-pyogenic infections. You can see the different varieties: pharyngitis, abscess, cellulitis, skin infections, scarlet fever, rheumatic fever, glomerulonephritis, reactive arthritis. These all infections can be caused by Streptococcus biogenes. Streptococcus agalactiae, they are very well known causative organism of neonatal pneumonia, neonatal meningitis. So there are varieties of infections among Streptococcus pneumoniae. Let me go back with you to this slide. I told you that alpha hemolytic, they are either Streptococcus pneumoniae or Streptococcus viridans. Up to this point, is it clear?
Yes.
Yes, doctor.
The question raised now, how to differentiate between Streptococcus pneumoniae and Streptococcus viridans in the initial stages of the culture process. For example, you have a patient in front of you right now. You have a patient in front of you now right now presented with typical picture of meningitis, fever, photophobia, neck stiffness. Okay? And you withdrew CSF and you send it to the lab. After a while, the lab called you. We have a gram-positive cocci in chains. Gram-positive cocci in chains. So they are either Streptococcus or Enterococcus. The next question you will ask the technician, is it PYR negative or positive? He will reply, it is PYR negative. So, gram-positive cocci in chains, PYR negative, this is Streptococcus. But I have alpha hemolytic and I have beta hemolytic. What is this? What could it be? The next question you will ask the lab, is it partial hemolysis or complete hemolysis? He will tell you, no, it's giving me greenish discoloration. So this is alpha hemolysis. Now, I know that this is alpha hemolysis. So it could be either Streptococcus viridans or pneumoniae. I want to know, is it pneumonia or Streptococcus viridans? What's your next question you will ask the technician in the lab? You will tell him about this test. Optician susceptibility test. Optician susceptibility test. Like this. This is the plate in the lab. And these are the colonies that contain the bacteria, the Streptococcus, the alpha hemolytic Streptococcus. You can see here, this is an optician disc. It's a disc contain an antibiotic. This contain an antibiotic. Optician is an antibiotic. Okay, it is enclosed in this disc. The technician will put it. And after that, he will see if there is an inhibition zone around it. For example, in the left side here, you can see there is an inhibition zone around the optician disc. It means that the colonies are sensitive to optician. While on the right side, there is no inhibition zone around the optician disc. It means that the colonies, the bacteria in these colonies are resistant or not sensitive to optician. This, how do you differentiate between Streptococcus pneumoniae, which is optician susceptible or sensitive, and Streptococcus viridans are optician resistant? And that's all for differentiation between Streptococcus pneumoniae and Streptococcus viridans. So you can see, in a while, if you are microbiologically oriented, microbiology oriented, you know, you are going to know what is the language that you are going to talk to the lab technician to facilitate or to ease the delivery of information to you. Is it PYR negative or positive? He will understand that you know what do you do exactly. You know what's your job. You know what do you do. No, doctor, it's PYR negative. PYR negative. It's a strip. But I want to know, is it alpha or beta? Is it partial hemolysis or complete hemolysis? No, doctor, it's partial hemolysis. Partial hemolysis. Okay, that's good. But I want to know, is it optician disc sensitive or optician disc resistant? No, doctor, there is an inhibition zone around the optician. So the patient is in front of you, and even before getting the final result, which is going to take around 3 to 5 days, you have a presumptive diagnosis about your organism in front of a patient of you that is having meningeal signs. And most likely, the causative organism is Streptococcus pneumoniae. You see how important is the microbiology? Even before getting the result, you can predict what is the most likely organism. And according to that, you can choose your antibiotic. That's clear, Jamal. I hope that's clear.
Yes, it's clear. Thank you, doctor.
You finding interesting or boring?
Very interesting.
In a summary, thank you very much. Streptococci, alpha hemolytic or beta hemolytic? Alpha hemolytic, we have Streptococcus pneumoniae, which can cause pneumonia, meningitis, otitis media, Streptococcus viridans, which can cause infective endocarditis. Streptococcus pneumoniae is an optician disc sensitive, while Streptococcus viridans are optician disc resistant. We have beta hemolytic that give you complete hemolysis, groups from A to H, as I have told you. The most important for you is group A, which is Streptococcus biogenes with different varieties of infections, and Streptococcus agalactiae, which is very important among neonates. The last or the third gram-positive cocci is enterococci. Again, I will go back to this slide. This is my major or master slide. Gram positive cocci. Catalase positive or negative? Positive, this is a star. Negative, next test, PYR, positive or negative? Negative, this is a stripped. Positive, this is enterococci, which was previously ordered or classified as a streptococci, but now it is a different entity. Enterococci. Enterococcus, formerly, as I have told you, was classified as group B streptococcus. Different and different species are under the umbrella of enterococci. Enterococcus faecalis, Enterococcus faecium, Enterococcus gallinarum, VRE, which is the abbreviation of vancomycin-resistant enterococci. They can do varieties of infections, UTI, wound infections, bacteremia. They are one of the causative organisms of endocarditis. Okay, and this is an example of antibiotic, of drug of choice that do cover VRE, which is the abbreviation of vancomycin resistant enterococci. Enterococci, previously they were very simple organisms, but with the use and overuse of antibiotics, they had different mutations resulting in this nasty organism called VRE, vancomycin resistant enterococci. And the drug of choice for VRE, either lenzolid, daptomycin, tigacycline. I hope that's clear, Jamra.
It's clear, Dr. Muhammad.
That's good. Okay, by this, I have finished the gram-positive cocci. Staph stripped enterococci. If I want to speak about each single species among these three organisms, I will take days and days. Okay, but I have given you now what important information you need to know among your clinical practice. Okay, do you have any questions so far concerning gram-positive cocci before moving to gram-positive bacilli?
No question until now.
That's good.
Excuse me, doctor, regarding vancomycin resistant enterococci, is it possible to give combination of ampicillin and gentamicin combination?
Ampicillin does not cover VRE. Once you have got VRE.
Gentamicin with gentamicin.
No, no.
Combination?
No, okay, no doctor. Combination. These are the antibiotic of choice covering VRE. Ampicillin and gentamicin combination, they don't cover VRE. Okay?
Okay.
So we have done with gram-positive cocci. Now let's move to gram-positive bacilli. Two main subcategories, either aerobic or anaerobic. The aerobic examples, Bacillus species, and one of the subspecies of Bacillus species is any volunteer? Bacillus what?
Bacillus anthrax.
Bacillus anthrax, صح. What else? Food poisoning, causing food poisoning. Bacillus what?
Clostridium perfringens.
I'm talking about Bacillus species. What kind of Bacillus species can cause food poisoning? Cereus, yes.
Bacillus cereus.
We have another type of aerobic gram-positive bacilli, which is Listeria monocytogenes. And what is the importance of knowing Listeria monocytogenes, guys? What does it cause? Yes, you are right. What does it cause?
Meningitis in old people and
meningitis. You are right. Is it only in old people?
And you need.
No, also.
You are right. What else?
Pregnant women.
Pregnant women. You are right. Yes. And immune compromised. Regardless what is the immune compromised status, either due to heavy use of steroids, cancer, chemotherapy, etc., etc. Have, if a patient presented to you, for example, is a 30-year-old male presented with picture typical of meningitis, by practice, you will give him empirically ceftriaxone and vancomycin. But if the same patient was a lady and pregnant, you will add ampicillin to cover the possibility of listeria. Ampicillin is the drug of choice of listeria species, which is a gram-positive bacilli. Another type is Corynebacterium. What other species of Corynebacterium do you know?
Diphtheria.
Diphtheria, you are right. And we have lactobacillus. In contrast, we have the anaerobic. The umbrella of anaerobic, we have Clostridium species and Propionibacterium species. My question now, what give me two infections, very common infections or conditions can be caused by Propionibacterium species?
Acne.
Acne, you are right. What else?
And prosthetic infection.
Prosthetic infection in joint infections. You are right. Thank you very much, doctor. And this is a summary of gram-positive bacilli infections. And see here, bacillus species. You already mentioned these guys. Listeria species, neonatal meningitis, and extremities of ages, pregnant ladies, immune compromised. You have Corynebacterium species. There are different species. Diphtheroid, ulcerinus, GKM, very important, especially people who work in ICU. This is a very common organism in line-related infections in ICU. You will get it in the gram-positive, in the gram-stain, gram-positive bacilli. Always suspect Corynebacterium GKM. Corynebacterium GKM, very important. Causative organism in Lyme-related infections, in particular in ICU cases. Lactobacillus, you have here the Clostridium species, effringes, difficile, tetani, botulinum, septicum, and finally Propionibacterium species, which can cause acne and different organisms. I have a very nice mnemonic. You can see it like this, A, B, C, D, L, P. Gram-positive bacilli or gram-positive rods, they are similar. Two different terms for one single entity. Gram-positive bacilli or gram-positive rod. A, B, C, D, L, P. A stands for actinomycetes. B stands for bacillus. C stands for Clostridium. D stands for diphtheria. L stands for listeria and lactobacillus. P stands for Propionibacterium acne. Hope that's clear, Jama. Clear.
Yes, clear, Dr. Muhammad.
You're finding interesting?
Yes, it's clear, Prof. Very interesting.
Okay. Forget about this question number one. Let's concentrate. Okay. I want a volunteer, please, to read the question number two. Who will volunteer? This is another introduction to another clinical trick. Just be careful. Who will be the volunteer?
Okay.
Hi, guys. I need a volunteer. Rishi, you volunteered before. I need someone else. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Who will volunteer? Shall I pick up? Come on, guys. Shall I stop, Khalas? You find it boring? Shall I stop? Okay. I will pick up someone. Dr. Ahmed Saleh. Are you around, Dr. Ahmed?
Yes.
Okay, Dr. Ahmed Saleh. How are you, Dr. Ahmed?
Fine.
Can you read the scenario, please? Scenario number two. And please, okay, guys, don't answer in the chat box. Don't answer. Continue. Go up. Please carry on, Dr. Ahmed.
27-year-old healthy lady present to emergency department complaining of profuse watery diarrhea after giving intravenous fluid. You notice that she was admitted last week due to right leg wound, which required dressing and wound care follow-up. Culture from the wound show MRSA, she was discharged on clindamycin. What is your impression?
Mm-hmm. 1 week ago, she came with wound infection, culture showed MRSA, the doctor prescribed her clindamycin. And now she came with profuse watery diarrhea. What's your impression?
This is colitis.
Clostridium difficile colitis. Yes, you are right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Diff colitis, Clostridium difficile infection. And now this is another clinical trick. Give me, Dr. Ahmed. Now we mentioned clindamycin. Give me another name or name another antibiotic or group of antibiotics that can cause Clostridium difficile infection. What else apart from clindamycin, Dr. Ahmed?
Start by seeing this.
Mention any name.
Ceftriaxone.
Ceftriaxone, okay, you are right. So guys, in order of high incidence, number one is clindamycin. Number two, cephalosporins. In particular, second and third cephalosporins. And then ciprofloxacin. Don't forget three C's in relation to Clostridium difficile infection, okay? But the take home message now, does Clostridium difficile infection associated only with antibiotics or there are other non-antibiotics drugs that can cause or predispose the patient to Clostridium difficile infection? What's the answer, yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, if you answer yes, give me the name of a non-antibiotic drug.
Proton pump inhibitors.
Proton pump inhibitors. Thank you very much, doctor. Now I have finished with the gram positive. Do you need to ask anything, guys?
No, doctor, continue.
Rather than antibiotic.
Any questions?
Yes, doctor, please.
Yes.
I didn't hear what was the second cause rather than antibiotic.
Yes, there are other types of medications that can predispose the patient to Clostridium difficile infection rather than antibiotics. For example, like proton pump inhibitors, omeprazole, esomeprazole, etc. These type of medications, they can predispose the patient to Clostridium difficile.
Oh, okay, thank you.
So by this slide, I am done with gram positive. Don't forget gram positive, blue. Gram positive, blue. Either cocci or bacilli. Cocci, either staph, stripped, entero. Bacilli, don't forget the mnemonic, A, B, C, D, L, P. That's all. I hope that's clear.
Yes, clear.
Okay, that's good. Let's take a break for around 8 minutes. Then we will come to classification of gram negative. 8 minutes, okay? Break. I will start at 9 sharp. Okay? See you after 8 minutes, inshallah.